talk to us about, Zoe's going to talk to us about this new app that she's been working on, and let us know what's happening in that space. I think it's a very exciting space. So thanks, Zoe. Over to you.
Okay, terrific. Thanks, Jenny, for that introduction. So yes, I was going to tag team originally with Sally on this presentation, but she unfortunately got COVID yesterday. So I'm flying solo, but thanks very much for this opportunity to present about mobile applications in pulmonary rehab. It's actually an area that Sally and I have been working on since about 2018, where we have been developing a specific application, which we've called Mobile Pulmonary Rehab, or MPR for short. What I'll do today is break the presentation up into three parts. I'll start off by discussing with you what the rationale behind developing a mobile health application in this area, what sort of supports that, and what our journey has looked like since 2018. The second part of the presentation, I'll go on and show you just some screenshots of what the MPR app actually looks like to give you an idea of what the patients see and what functionality it has. And then at the end of the presentation, I'll talk to you about a company that we're now working with called Perks Health, who's actually helping us to commercialise this platform. Now, we all know that there are a large number of pulmonary rehab programs in Australia, and that most of them are centre-based programs that are in large metropolitan and regional centres. We also know that one of the major problems we have with our pulmonary rehab programs is getting people with lung diseases to have access to these programs. So for some time now, across Australia, there have been various research groups working to try and come up with some alternatives to centre-based pulmonary rehab that are still an effective way to deliver pulmonary rehab. Anne Holland's group in Victoria have been doing an excellent job with some rigorous clinical trials, looking at home-based pulmonary rehab as an alternative to centre-based pulmonary rehab, and they've shown that type of service delivery is effective. We've also, a number of us have been looking at home-based tele-rehab. Even before COVID hit, we'd started to have a look at this type of delivery of care, and my then PhD student, Ling Ling Zai, who'd be on the line, did some work comparing tele-rehab to usual care and showed that it was more effective than usual care. And more recently, Narelle Cox's team in Victoria have published their very large tele-rehab study, which has been published in Thorax, also showing that tele-rehab is a viable alternative to a centre-based program. So this really raises the issue of whether we can also develop a mobile health platform to assist these home-based programs. And when we started this journey in 2018, whilst there were programs that were Australian-specific available in the cardiac rehab space that were mHealth programs, there was nothing specific that had been designed for pulmonary rehab. So if you're not sure what I'm talking about here when I'm talking about a mobile pulmonary rehab platform, it's really all about allowing people with chronic respiratory diseases to perform their exercise training, their education, and their self-management support at home, supported by technology like iPhones or Android devices, or iPads or tablet devices. So that's what the patients are generally looking at when they're being delivered the service. What you as clinicians are usually interacting with through these platforms is a web-based portal. So when we first came up with the idea of whether we could start to kind of develop a new model of care to deliver pulmonary rehab in this way, we asked ourselves two initial questions. We clearly needed to know whether people with COPD would be able to manage a platform like this using their smartphone or Android devices. And we were able to sort of successfully answer that question with an honours project, which was a survey study that we ran with a couple of hundred patients with COPD recruited from Sydney centre-based pulmonary rehab programs. And that group of people told us that they did actually have high use of mobile phone technology and that they did have an interest in receiving tele-rehab services with that type of technology. So that kind of gave us the impetus to keep proceeding with this idea of developing a mobile platform. We then needed to think about who would help us design and build the platform. And initially, I was attracted to the Australian eHealth Research Centre. This is a group that belonged to the CSIRO, because they were the ones that developed one of the initial Australian-based platforms for cardiac rehab. They labelled that platform at the time Motor. They put it through a clinical trial and showed that it was effective. And many of you may now know that that platform has been taken to the commercialised company called CardiHab. So just to give you an idea how this has proceeded in terms of a timeline, I can tell you this has gone much, much slower than I ever intended it to. But it has been an interesting journey. It really first began in February 2018. Sally Wooten, Jenny Allison and myself, we flew up to the Australian eHealth Research Centre in Brisbane to have a bit of a talk with that team about whether this was a worthwhile project to pursue with them. Thankfully, we left that conversation and felt that it was something to kind of proceed with. However, we then spent 2 years essentially finding funding to help us develop this platform and actually getting the collaborative research agreement signed across a number of stakeholders that we then drew into the platform. So you can see all the major stakeholders involved in this process with their little icons represented on the bottom of the slide. So we were actually, so it did take us actually 2 years to get to the point where we could then get CSIRO to start actually building this platform for us. And they took about 12 months to kind of put together with lots of to-ing and fro-ing and feedback from us and from consumers developing that platform for us, which we're now calling MPR. The other thing I started to do through that time was I wasn't just interested in being able to build the platform. We really wanted to have enough funds to also evaluate the platform. So I then spent the next 2 years with my team trying to find more funds to put into the research program. Thankfully, we've found enough money to support some clinical trials using a PhD student and a master's student. I also got advised throughout 2020 that it would probably be a good idea to try and find a commercial partner to work with even before we knew the outcomes of the research. Thankfully, I met an organisation called Perks Health towards the end of 2020, actually, and we got chatting about the platform that they had already developed and what we had developed through MPR. And we've kind of collaborated together, and I've actually won a Ready Fellowship this year. So I'm not actually at the university at the moment. I'm seconded across to Perks Health, actually working within their organisation to commercialise this MPR app. Okay, if we move on to the second part of the presentation, which is where I want to show you some of the screenshots so you can understand what the MPR prototype actually looks like. So this is the platform that CSIRO have built for us. This is a platform which is at the moment only sitting in research and cannot be rolled out sort of outside of research at the moment. It basically what we get our researchers to do is patients who are agreeing to be part of the research, they come to one of our centre-based programs within the Northern Sydney Local Health District. The researchers carry out their usual initial face-to-face assessments like you do in a standard pulmonary rehab program. Once they've got all of that information in front of them, then they're able to prescribe the exercise program that they want people to do through this particular application. They help the patient face-to-face to onboard onto the system and to download the app from the app stores. And they put them through a little bit of an education process so that they know how to then go away and use the app at home on their own. However, they do through the course of the 8-week program. So we're running this as sort of a very stock standard conventional Australian-based pulmonary rehab program, encouraging people to sort of exercise 3 times a week and do it across the course of an 8-week program. But our research is actually a bit like some of the other home-based programs, do give a phone call to patients on a weekly basis to check in how they're going, to understand how they've gone with their exercise program that week and to help push through new information about what the dosage of the exercise prescription should be in the following weeks. Okay, so if you have a look at the little home screen that we've got pictured here inside the mobile phone, you know, we use motivational phrases of the day. We ask people to tell us each day how they're feeling using little smiley faces or sad faces. And then the horizontal tabs on this app are sort of showing you the functionality that MPR has. So the first thing that MPR can do is remotely measure patients' symptoms. I'll show you a few screens about how we do that, but the idea is that we can try and detect someone deteriorating earlier than we might otherwise have and help them with earlier intervention, particularly around their medications or going and seeing their GP if they need to. A second functionality, the platform is actually delivering their full weekly rehab program that consists of the exercise training and education components. Another piece of functionality on the app is being able to set health goals with the patient. So this might be things like physical activity step information. It might be nutritional dietary information, and a patient can go into that enter daily targets section and actually indicate to us how they're going with those health goals. We also have a number of surveys or questionnaires that have been digitalised into the app. The COPD assessment test and the MMRC dyspnea scale are both performed on a weekly basis. And finally, we have digitalised Lung Foundation Australia's action plan. So patients can, if they've got an action plan, we're able to push information through about that action plan to patients so they know what medications they're taking when they're stable and what medications they need to take when they're unwell. So the way the therapist actually connects with this system is through a web-based portal. A therapist is completely able to use the portal to send through information to the app about the weekly rehab, about the daily targets, and about the information that they need to put into their action plan. If we go into a little bit more detail, if, for example, the patient wants to look at the daily symptoms section, they can press on the daily symptoms tab. Patients then get taken through about 8 questions, asking them about things like their breathlessness, how they're feeling in terms of coughing, are they producing sputum, what sort of volume is it, what sort of colour is it, are they having a fever, do they feel like they're having a flare-up? They're those sorts of symptomatic questions that we get them to complete for us. Patients themselves are actually able to track over time how they're responding to those questions, and all their responses are pushed down through into the therapist portal. So we're alerted to anyone who might be experiencing a symptom deterioration. That then allows us to send messages around, looking at their action plans or going and seeing their GP. In terms of a bit more detail around the weekly rehab program, when they first press in on that particular tab, they actually get taken to some safety screens, which make sure that it's okay for the person to exercise that day. But otherwise, they get a week by week screen that indicates what they need to do. The grey area is showing you the education videos that patients are asked to watch. The white area is showing you the exercise sessions that we ask them to be involved in. In terms of the exercise sessions, they click in on one of these exercise sessions, and then that takes them to a list of exercises. So you can see here in the far right, the week 5, session 4 list of exercises. Each exercise has an exercise video associated with it. They just need to press on this little triangle here and they can actually watch a video explaining to them how to do the exercises, how intensely they should be trying to do that. They can then click in on the word, say, biceps curls, and that takes them through to further screens that provides the individual dosage for each of these exercises. Obviously, the patient then goes away and completes some of those exercises and can come back to the app and actually fill in exactly what they did do around that particular dosage. Just to show you a few pictures of what the exercise videos look like, we've ended up making about 13 exercise videos, everything from showing people how to use treadmills and bikes to ground-based walking, stepping, a whole lot of arm exercises. These videos can be downloaded or streamed through the app. They tend to be around about 3 to 5 minutes, and they're very much informational videos. So they aren't videos that they need to watch usually more than 1 or 2 times. They're not videos that they watch while they're exercising. They're things that they watch before they actually exercise. Furthermore, just to give you a bit of an idea what our education videos look like, here this slide sort of indicates to you the various topics that we have developed videos on. This has really been led by Sally Wooten and her team at Northern Sydney Local Health District, where she got her multidisciplinary team to help contribute to creating this set of videos. Interestingly, again, these tend to run for about a 5 to 8 minute period of time. We stream through week by week which education videos we want them to watch, usually about 3 to 4 per week. However, if patients want to watch videos outside of the actual rehab tab, we've created a library of videos which they can actually access from the homepage, everything from their list of education videos to exercise videos. And the other set of video resources we have built into this app, which have come from Lung Foundation Australia, are inhaler medication videos. So the therapist can push up the correct inhaler videos for patients to watch, so that can be individualised. The final piece of functionality I want to mention to you around the NPR prototype is that we've also set about creating a bank of text messages which we can send through to patients, kind of to promote their own self-management skills. out of the 90 messages that we developed, and we did this with some consumer design and also with a number of multidisciplinary team members across a range of actually Sydney-based LHDs, we've ended up setting 26 mandatory messages. So about 3 to 4 messages get pushed through each week across the 8 weeks. They tend to be motivational messages around exercise or particularly on an educational topic. However, therapists then have an opportunity to go into the clinician portal and select any of the other 60 messages that we've created based on patients' needs. So if for example, you've got a smoker in your program and you want to push through some smoking support messages, you can do that. You can see also in the examples that I've given you here that we've got quite a few reminder messages as well. So in a nutshell, that's the functionality that the MPR platform has. But remember, that's the platform that is sitting inside research at the moment. And our expectation is that that research will continue to about the end of next year. So we should be starting to get some outcomes about that work from around about 2024, where we're directly comparing the MPR app to a centre-based program. Because of the length of time that research takes and advice that I was given around kind of seeking out commercial partners, I can now let you know that what we've moved on to is working with this company called Perks Health. Now, Perks Health are an established digital health company. They've existed since 2016, and they've got operations across Australia and into the USA. And their original mission was really to create a daily, or the world's leading daily engagement platform, essentially for fairly high-risk polychronic patients. Like the MPR app, Perks Health have created a platform which contains a participant app, which obviously the patients access, as well as a virtual care suite, which is the web-based portal that you as a therapist would access. Where Perks Health are different to most of the other chronic disease platforms that I have seen around Australia and globally, is that they have very much focused on wanting to drive engagement in using the technology first, and then pushing through the appropriate sort of treatments, health information. So they've spent quite a lot of money pulling together a very sophisticated engagement app. And they've really drawn from other industries where we as humans engage quite well in technology. Think of Facebook, think of Netflix, think of the language platform Duolingo. Those platforms have amazing sort of engagement techniques built into them, and very much Perks have drawn from those to kind of get people to engage in daily health behaviours. So that's where it's quite different to the MPR app, which tended to just be sort of sending health content and health information to patients. This has this also engagement-focused set of features. They describe their app as being an all-in-one self-management tool, and that's fairly believable because it can actually, it's a highly flexible tool that works very well for chronic conditions, but it can be used for sort of any chronic condition that you would like. It's not a respiratory-specific app other than what I've started to build inside it. They can push through a number of treatments. They can push through digital resources and tools. So everything happens to sit in the one place. So I think it probably can be quite correctly described as a super app. In terms of the virtual care suite that you guys would access as therapists, this has also got a range of features. It has its own video conferencing technology in it. You're able to see any of the remote monitoring that patients are pushing down through the app. You're able to see any PROMs and PREMs that patients fill out, and any overall adherence to their treatment plan. So again, quite a sophisticated virtual care suite. If I just explain a little bit further how...
Sorry, just a point. Have you got many more slides? Just don't want to run over too much time. That was all.
Only about 2 more, Jenny.
Yeah, sounds great. Thanks. Sorry.
Yep. So just to... Just to sort of finish off to say, one really nice thing about the infrastructure to Perks Health is it is a no-code configurable platform. So someone like me who comes along with no tech experience has been able to push up health content, treatment plans and resources and tools that are very respiratory specific. So if I just show you what some of those things look like, this is essentially Perks' homepage. They have functionality that works from this horizontal bar on the bottom of their app. So when you press on the Today screen, a patient can see all their treatment plans scheduled, whether it be medications, the exercise program, collection of activity data or other health goals, even health appointments can be scheduled into the app. You can see from the squiggly lines some of the functionality that this app has. So we can push through and look at medication adherence issues. Patients can actually see what medications they need to take, the dosage. They can click on these little task cards, and it even lets them take a photo of their medication so they can verify that they've been adherent with their medication use. I've been able to push through onto this app all of the same functionality that NPR has around walking training, the walking videos, the PROMs and PREMs. There's a whole database that Perks have created with a whole variety of PROMs and PREMs, but I've pushed through the MMRC dyspnea scale and the COPD assessment test. They have a health hub where there's lots of information. There's resources to take them to Lung Foundation Australia. All of the medication, not the medications, the video resources all sit inside the health hub. And this is just a way to sort of show you one little aspect of the engagement aspects of the platform. So people can even complete their tasks and then play some little 10, 15 second games and then be rewarded for that. So this is sort of showing you, I think this person's won a little $5 Kmart gift card. So this is the way they kind of hang a hook to get people to keep being adherent with the tasks. I'll just finish off by saying Perks is a fairly easy company to work with. They're fairly low risk to get started. They work very closely with you around a pre-launch strategy, trying to identify what conditions you're interested in managing. Obviously, we're all interested in respiratory conditions and pulmonary rehab patients. They don't just sort of hand over their technology and then leave you alone. They remain very focused with you in terms of launching the platform with you, maximizing enrollment onto the platform. And they have their own customer-facing teams and data analysts that are kind of feeding you monthly reports about how engaged people are on your platform and what the outcomes are of, you know, using the platform at that time. They only charge you for active engagement of participants. And of course, one of the lovely things about working with a commercialized company is they've already spent the millions of dollars making sure that their platforms are secure. So because they work across Australia and the US, they've got very high security standards around their privacy and data. So Jenny, what I might do is just leave it there, other than to say, if any of you are interested in hearing a little bit more about this platform, that's what I'm sitting over in Perks Health doing at the moment. I've really only scratched the surface on what this Perks app can actually do. If you'd like to see more comprehensive demos, please feel free to kind of email me here at my Perks Health email. My only one suggestion to you is worth having a discussion with your managers about this as well. We tend to like doing demos with both the funders and the clinicians, so that we're able to talk to both of you at the same time. That's only my little hint there. But otherwise, Jenny, happy to take some questions.
Yeah, thanks, Zoe, and thanks very much. It's a really interesting thing. The only thing I was just going to say was that the way it's planned at the moment, all patients would have a face-to-face assessment prior to starting in the rehab section of the apps, just so that the exercises can be, unless I missed you saying that, so that there's a prescription is appropriate for each individual patient.
Yep. So I mentioned that with NPR, and it's exactly the same with Perks Respiratory. Right. You have to begin with a face-to-face initial assessment, and then that feeds you the information that you need to push into the prescription.
Okay, just a couple of really quick questions. Jamie asks, would there be a cost to the patient, which I think you answered.
The cost for the Perks. So Perks is a platform that we can now roll out to all sort of Australian-based pulmonary rehab programs. It doesn't cost to the patients. The way that Perks prices in all of this is a cost to your LHD or your health organisation or area. They charge out to the overall organisation so that patients are then accessing it for free.
Okay, and I think you answered partly the other question from Lorraine, which was about the security of the data and which country this company has a server where the data is kept.
Yep, the data is actually kept through Amazon Web Services, and they are servers in Australia.
Yep, and Caitlin, I think we've answered your question about cost to the health service. And Josh Bishop's asking...
Which I didn't quite answer, Jenny, because I said that there wasn't a cost to a patient, but I might take any costing information offline. I can speak you through it, but Perks are very happy to begin pilot programs. There is a cost involved, but they're happy to work in a pilot way first before any major expansion of the platform across your area districts.
Thanks, Zoe. Look, there are a couple more questions, but I think we might answer those online. I will save the questions for you and we'll get back to Josh and Bibiana about their questions, if that's all right. Thanks so much. Really interesting to see this progressing so well. Thanks, Zoe. Now, I do know that we have Sophie Mummery and Jessica Beeman online to give us a Tasmanian update. So over to you. I'm not sure whether you're both speaking or if it's you, Sophie.
Yep, no worries.
Oh, you're both there.
We are both here. Sorry. It'll be Jess today, but we'll just look at how to share our screen quickly.
Yeah, terrific. Thank you very much. Yeah. We've missed you in our last state update, so it's lovely to have you here. Thank you.
And then that should be share, and then, oh, it's just in the task. Oh.
Just go up to display settings and change it to presenter view in the very top. Next one along. That the display settings, that middle one at the very top bar.
Yeah, just the Zoom taskbar's in the way.
Ah, right. Yeah. I wish I could click it for you.
Next one
along. If you go to your right, just a fraction.
No, it's like underneath.
And it's underneath. Yeah, and the Zoom taskbar won't let us.
Can you move this? Oh, it doesn't matter. It's
oh, yeah, there you go. Okay.
Task.
That's it.
Perfect.
That's it. Thanks.
Yeah, go for it. Awesome. Thank you. So sorry that we were a bit late today, Jenny. We've just been asked to give an update on the what's been happening in Tassie during the pandemic. And as Jenny said, my name's Jess, and we're working down here in Hobart in the Pulmonary Rehab Service with Sophie. This one? Sorry, just having issues getting the slides going. Next, there we go. Despite having a lengthy period of time in Tassie without lockdowns and without COVID, with a COVID zero approach, the Tassie Pulmonary Rehab Service has still been quite impacted by the pandemic. In March 2020, the services still experienced a shutdown, and that was for about 8 weeks. At this time, the existing patients were transitioned to a home-based model of care, and new clients weren't enrolled until we were allowed to complete face-to-face assessments again in Tassie. So this model continued until September 2020, so for quite a few months, at which point the centre-based groups restarted. Due to the pandemic, there were, precautions in place, such as density limits, smaller group sizes, cleaning, PPE, that kind of thing. And during this time, a home-based model was still kept as an option, and this was for patients that had maybe travel restrictions or lived regionally, or those who wanted to shield themselves from further exposure. During this period of 2020, the northwest area of Tassie had significant staffing issues, so they actually didn't recommence their groups until late 2021, which was just before the borders opened. As you can see, sorry, I think there's an announcement, so hopefully that's not too loud, but as you can see in the graph, there was quite a long period of, sorry, I just let that finish because I can't hear myself think.
Masks must be worn in all facilities, no food can be shared, and children are recommended to be left at home where possible.
Sorry, it's quite a long announcement.
It's okay.
So as you can see, we had quite a long period of COVID zero, but as soon as the borders opened in the middle of December last year, we started getting COVID cases in Tassie. So as a result of that, the service was shut down again in December 2021, and a home-based model was reinstated. The difference this time around was that there were some exemptions made for high-risk patients being allowed to come in face-to-face, and so that's been able to happen since December, and currently we're still running this sort of home-based modified service and aren't back to face-to-face yet. In terms of the barriers that we're facing down in Tassie, so similarly to around the country, obviously there's still COVID-19 and influenza waves happening at the moment, so that's been limiting our ability to reopen our face-to-face groups. Other factors that are at play are sort of the patient preference. So we still have quite a lot of patients who don't want to be near the hospital at all, and sometimes they don't even want to come in for a face-to-face assessment. So that's been limiting our ability to provide these people with a safe or suitable exercise program. There are also some patients on the other side of things who don't want to do remote models of care. They don't think that they'd be suitable. And so they are waiting. They're just happy to wait on the wait list until a face-to-face option comes available for them. In Tassie, technology is quite a significant barrier. That's because most of our patient cohort don't have access to the internet. They don't use emails. They don't have devices. And so it's quite difficult in those settings to provide that sort of remote method of care. There are also lots of rural areas of Tassie in which there's not even phone reception. So for those patients, even the home-based option isn't viable. Literacy levels in Tassie are also quite low, with approximately 50% of people being illiterate. So this, I guess, means that even regardless of whether they've got tech access or tech ability, sometimes the patients might not understand the information that we might send them or mail them, or they might not be able to read it. As well as this, we've also had quite long waiting lists in Tassie, so even prior to the pandemic, but this has, I guess, since blown out. So for example, waiting times for CAT2s are in the northwest longer than 3 years, in the south, which is where we are in Hobart, about 2 years, and in the north, which is Launceston, 12 months. So as a result of this, when we are seeing our patients, they've often, their condition may have deteriorated, they might be more complex and with significant comorbidities by the time we're seeing them. And this is making our treatments of them more resource intensive and often difficult for us to find safe and appropriate patients for these more remote models. Staffing has also been quite a significant barrier across the whole state, but particularly in the northwest. So that's up near Burnie. Our pulmonary rehab physio up there, she also covers the general wards, the medical wards, ICU, ED, PEDS, respiratory outpatients, and the groups. So that's quite a lot for one person to do. That's been very tricky for her up there. And as well, with prolonged vacancies across the state, we've been sometimes pulled to acute areas. Staffing's been also limited in the south as well, with only one physio to cover pulmonary rehab, heart failure, and the respiratory outpatients. And with these challenges, it makes it difficult to implement these more resource-intensive models of care. In terms of our future directions, we are thinking that, this hybrid model is probably going to be something here to stay in Tassie, so including sort of a home base and a centre base mix. We haven't trialled any online group classes or tele rehab, mostly due to resourcing and also that tech literacy challenges, but that could be something we consider. We're also at the moment thinking about how we might transition our education to a more online or remote format so that it's more accessible for those that are in home based. But again, we're just needing to consider how we do that to meet the needs of our clientele. And we're hoping to stay connected with each other. So we have regular statewide catch ups, and then as well with the Pulmonary Rehab Network, because this provides us with lots of support and guidance, which is otherwise unavailable to us in this rural setting. So that's all from us.
Terrific. Excellent report. Thanks, Jess. And also thanks, Sophie, for being part of that as well. Yeah. I think, the way I hear it, it's pretty similar to the problems around the rest of the country. And so it's good to just catch up with you and have that report on file so that we can keep that. And I think your points of working together to try and help each other, especially when there are staff shortages like we've all got, is a really important thing as well. So maybe we'll catch up with you after this and see what other ways that the network can help you if possible. Yeah, we can't fly staff down, I know, but there might be other ways that we can do that. So thank you so much for providing that report. We move on now. Sorry. Yeah, thanks, guys. We'll move on now because Emma's going to give us an update on the PUMI rehab audit that was done by the Lung Foundation and a service directory update. So over to you. Thanks, Emma.
Okay. Thanks very much, Jenny. Firstly, I just want to say a huge thanks on behalf of Lung Foundation to everybody who completed the PR audit. And we had a fantastic response. We have 324 services on our directory. And 53% of those responded to the audit, which is excellent. So many of you provided updated details on your service to be carried across to the new directory, which is expected to launch at the end of the month. Once the directory has gone live, I'm going to be sending a link to everybody so you're able to view your service details and see how the new platform works. Health professionals and consumers will be able to do a radius search within their local area to see what details we have on the CRM for your service. The record will include referrals, cost, program duration, class location, contact name, email, and number. If you haven't provided us with this information, that's fine. The fields will just not appear. The email will also include a link to an online form, which will give you an opportunity to update your details or let us know if the service is no longer running. Now, the audit provided us with some interesting insights into PR across Australia, and I'm going to share a few of those with you now. So firstly, 89% of programs now accept patients with any type of conditions, including lung cancer. So this has increased by from 2017, when only 52% of services accepted all conditions. The audit also told us that a massive 59% of programs are supporting patients with long COVID, and 69% of services are supporting patients who have been in hospital due to COVID. 80% of programs offer patient education, which isn't surprising, as part of their service, and nutrition and healthy eating, information on diseases, physical exercise, coping with lung disease, and management of depression, anxiety, and panic attacks are the most common topics. 84% of services accept GP referrals, as opposed to 46% to accept self-referrals. 51% accept a specialist referral. And just to be clear, you are allowed to make multiple responses to this question. So we could have both a GP and a specialist referring into your accept GP and specialist referrals into your program. We also asked you what type of health professionals were involved in your program. And again, we allowed multiple responses to this question. 87% of programs involve a physiotherapist, and 62% involve a nurse, and 33% involve AEPs. There is a strong indication of a return to centre-based programs, with 88% of services offering a hospital outpatient or community health program, and 23% offer a home-based program, and 15% now only offer an online service. Nearly 50% of services said you would have benefited from a local maintenance exercise program being set up. For those of you that aren't aware, LFA govern a maintenance program called Lungs in Action. A number of these services closed during the pandemic, but we're now at a stage where we plan to rebuild the program across Australia. So we've commenced a 6-month growth campaign. We've focused on raising awareness of the program within the sports industry, with a goal to recruit new instructors in underserviced areas. Our training program has been streamlined to make it easier for new instructors to achieve accreditation, and we have an online framework for the program to accommodate rural and remote locations. It's our long-term goal to have a maintenance class within 10k of each of the PR services across Australia. So please, if you know someone who's looking to establish a service, then please send their details over to me or ask them to get in touch so we can make it happen. Now, a summary of the audit results are going to be posted on the new PR toolkit, which is set to launch in a few weeks' time. For those of you that haven't come across the toolkit yet, this is an information site predominantly for new clinicians who are looking at setting up a PR service. The site contains resources on patient assessment, education, and guidance on exercise prescription. The toolkit has recently undergone a major clinical review with a panel of 10 clinicians, including Jenny and Zoe from today's presentation. And this has been redeveloped to improve its design and ease of navigation. So the new site is expected to launch at the end of the month. The information we collect from the audit will also provide us with strong data to support our PR advocacy work. So over the next few months, LFA will hold a PR strategy session with a panel of key opinion leaders to discuss future direction of the PR network and our advocacy goals. So we're going to discuss the viability of submitting another MBS item to the Medical Services Advisory Committee, looking to see if we're able to provide increased evidence into the benefits of PR for other patient cohorts other than COPD, which is where we fell short on the last application. But more to come on that in the next session. Finally, if you haven't registered for the online community of practice, I'll post a registration link in the chat now if you want to do so. The forum's got over 150 members, and posts have included job advertisements, journal articles, and requests for information. And now I will pass back to Jenny to introduce our speakers for the Pitch the Project section.
Thanks, Emma. And that's great work that Lung Foundation's doing. And thanks for all the work around and others around the toolkit update. And that audit is really important also for advocacy. So we have a series of Pitch Your Project, which I think is a really nice opportunity for people who are doing some research for us to hear about it. I'm sorry we're running short of time, but we will make it through these presentations, which I'm sure everyone will enjoy. So Lara, Ed, Brooke, would you like to start your presentation, and we will go from there? Maybe we won't have that much time for questions, but at least you get the chance to tell us what you're doing. So Lara, I saw you were there. There you are.
I'm here, Jenny.
Yep.
I'll just hopefully move into presenter mode.
Yep, perfect.
Able to see my slides?
Yeah, it looks gorgeous. Thank you.
Brilliant. Okay, I'll be brief too to help us catch up. So first of all, I just wanted to thank Jenny and Emma very much for the opportunity to present today. It's really great. And I'm just going to talk very briefly about my current Victorian Cancer Agency Fellowship project that I'm working on in collaboration with LFA. And you can see from the title there, it's called Lung Cancer Rehabilitation, Standardizing Evaluation and Co-Designing a Program for People During Immunotherapy. Short title is the UNITE study, so that might be easier to remember. I was asked to give a little bit of background about myself. So I'm a rehab physio. I'm currently working at Melbourne Uni in the physio department and also at Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre in Melbourne in the Department of Health Services Research. And my research interests are really surround generating new evidence regarding the effectiveness of rehab in oncology, including different models of care delivery and digital health, but also about understanding the experiences of people with cancer who participate in rehab. And I finished a PhD in 2019, where we investigated the effectiveness of a home-based rehabilitation program for people with inoperable lung cancer, and that was part of a larger NHMRC project grant. And then in 2020, I was fortunate to hold a Cancer Council Victoria fellowship, and we looked at the cost effectiveness of that program. And I'm now moving on to a VCA fellowship. And I just wanted to briefly tell you a little bit mainly about the first study in my fellowship. So it surrounds developing a core set of lung cancer rehabilitation outcomes for use in clinical practice, so in lung cancer rehab programs. So I'm particularly happy to hear from Emma about how many programs, pulmonary rehab programs, are now accepting lung cancer referrals. It's fantastic. And I guess my interest in developing a core or a minimum outcome set stemmed from some work I did in my PhD, where we undertook a systematic review of different ways that physical activity was measured for people with lung cancer. And we identified that there were 21 different ways that researchers were currently measuring physical activity in lung cancer. We couldn't synthesize our results because of that. So, you know, the aim of this project is really to develop a patient-centered set of minimum outcomes to reduce burden on patients and healthcare providers associated with collection of less relevant outcomes, and also addressing that reduction in research waste by not being able to synthesize results and looking at harmonizing results in future research trials. And an important component of the work will be that once we've developed the core outcome set, they'll be linked to the pulmonary rehab toolkit. That's an old screenshot of the old toolkit that you can see there. And so we've done some preliminary work for the Delphi study to develop the core outcome set last year. So we conducted an overview of systematic reviews looking at exercise programs, RCTs for people with lung cancer. And we've also had a PhD student, you may have seen the ad on the workplace chat, a PhD student with a survey that's still open currently asking clinicians about outcome measures that are used commonly in rehab for people with lung cancer who've had surgical management. And we also conducted some focus groups last year with patients and with caregivers to hear from them about what outcomes of lung cancer rehab are important from their perspectives. So from that preliminary work, we've developed a very long list of outcomes. And the next part of the program of work, as I said, is the Delphi study, which I'm really keen to get all of your involvement in. We will have separate panels representing consumer, healthcare professional and clinician researchers. And so the survey will be open to any healthcare professional that's working to deliver lung cancer rehabilitation for patients undergoing any kind of treatment for lung cancer or following treatment for lung cancer. And there'll be two parts. So the first part of the study will involve determining what to measure. So we'll present you with the whole list of outcomes and get your input into what outcomes you think are important as that minimum set of outcomes that we should be measuring. So I'll advertise when the survey's open. We're just in the process of getting ethics approval to commence, and then I'll pop an ad on the Pulmonary Rehab Network workplace group. So if you're able to participate, it'll take about 10 minutes of your time, and there'll probably be two rounds of the survey and then potentially a meeting afterwards if we haven't managed to reach consensus. And then there'll be a second part in which we determine how to measure. So for our core outcomes, we'll send out another survey asking about the different tools that we could use to measure those outcomes and to get your opinion on the importance of those different tools. And then eventually we will arrive at some recommendations regarding the sort of tools that should be used to measure each of those core outcomes. I won't take any more time up, but I just wanted to let you know the second part of my project, which will probably start next year, will be around co-designing a rehab program for people who are specifically having immunotherapy treatments for lung cancer. And so again, I'll probably pop some messages onto the workplace group asking for some participation in the co-design process. So that's all from me. Once again, thanks for the time. Happy to take questions in the chat, or if anyone wants to email me, that's how you find me. Thank you.
Terrific. Thanks, Lara, and huge congratulations on getting those fellowships. They're very competitive, and so that's wonderful to see your work happening. And if people want to ask Lara questions, could you please pop them in the chat? Lingling, Hayley's asked if she could go next because she's got to go and teach. So, Hayley, would you like to present your work, and then we could pop across to Lingling. So go right ahead. Yeah.
Excellent. Thanks. Thank you so much, Jenny, and thank you for inviting me to present my project. So I'm doing an online survey looking at how exercise is currently prescribed in pulmonary rehab programs across Australia. Just my background, I'm a lecturer in exercise physiology at the University of Newcastle, and I'm an exercise physiologist. And so as this project suggests, my research interest is in optimizing physical activity and exercise for people who have chronic lung disease. So the online survey is in two parts. Firstly, we want to survey healthcare professionals who work in pulmonary rehab, so everyone here, and who also prescribe the exercise for people who attend the program, or you know the exercise that is prescribed for people who attend the program. And then the second survey is to get the patient's perspective. So we want to hear from people with COPD who have completed pulmonary rehab recently, with recently being in the last 2 years. So looking at the first survey of healthcare professionals, the two big questions that we want to know is just simply how is exercise most commonly prescribed, and really looking at the intensity of that exercise. So for example, what assessments do you do to inform your exercise prescription, if any? And then if you do these assessments, how are these data used? And then also really importantly, especially in centres outside of major cities, how is the availability of different resources? How does this influence your current practices around prescription of exercise intensity? So would you lack additional resources to support your exercise prescription? And if so, what additional resources do you think would be important? So why do I want this information? I really want to compare what's I guess, idealistic and what's in the clinical practice guidelines, which a lot of the time says things like doing a cardiopulmonary exercise test, which is really resource intensive, versus what do people actually do in real life across Australia, and people who work in programs of different settings, so who have different personnel available, different staff, different professional profiles of their staff, different equipment and different monetary resources. And another reason too is to inform research going forward. So a lot of the time, of course, we compare new exercise interventions or a new way to do exercise to pulmonary rehab, which is the standard of care. But if you were to design a research study and you didn't have access to an existing established pulmonary rehab program to be the control group, how can we as researchers design the best intervention that most closely reflects what is usual care? But then also, is there a need for additional resources in different centres to support exercise prescriptions so that it is really consistent across centres regardless of your access to resources? And then so from people with COPD, what we want to know is just their perception of how the exercise intensity was prescribed. So was it easier or harder than they expected? Would they want it to be easier or harder? Do they have any recommendations for improvement that would help them to exercise at the intensity they believe they should be exercising at? And do they have any fears about certain types of exercise? So particularly maybe exercising at higher intensities. And so really, I want to know this information to look at whether real life practices do align with patient expectations, which may have implications for adherence or attending a program again if they've already attended one. So that's basically the summary of the surveys. And so how to complete the surveys for healthcare professionals who work in pulmonary rehab and prescribe exercise, they can follow this link and I'll provide the link to Emma and pop it in some platforms, or just scan this QR code as we're all used to now. But then the one for people with COPD is a little bit, Yeah, like I said, it's for any healthcare professionals who work in pulmonary rehab and prescribe exercise. If that's not you, but you work in pulmonary rehab and you would want to distribute that information to the people who do prescribe the exercise, I can provide that link as well for you to distribute to those staff. The one for people with COPD is a bit harder to get out. So this is anyone with COPD who is either currently attending pulmonary rehab or who has attended the rehab before. I've provided resources in a OneDrive folder so that I can distribute that link, or I can get Emma to distribute that link. And then in that folder has the flyer that you could place in your pulmonary rehab program or provide to participants of your program. And then I also have an information sheet, so I just give the participants a bit more information about the survey and why we're doing it. And then it also has my contact details if they want to reach out to me. So what I'll do following this presentation is I'll provide the links for the healthcare professional survey and then the OneDrive with the COPD resources to Emma, and then also provide some communication and workplace around the surveys and how to access those surveys. And thank you for your time.
Thanks, Hayley. It sounds like a really interesting project. Lovely to hear that the consumers are being asked their opinions, so that'll be really interesting. In the interest of time, any questions for Hayley, please pop them in the chat. And now I would like to invite Lingling to talk about her research project. Thanks, Lingling. Lingling Sai.
Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Yep. And can you see the slide?
Yep.
So thank you. So I won't take up too much of your time. And my project, actually, my recent project, has quite a few overlap with Lara's research project as well. I would like to first thank the Lung Foundation, Jenny and Emma, to give me this opportunity to present here today. And most of my research, research co-investigators are online today. Jenny Allison, Renate McNamara, and Zoe. And I'm currently working at the Royal Prince Alfred Hospital as a physio in pulmonary rehab and a research associate with Jenny Allison at the University of Sydney. So pulmonary rehab, the title of my study is called The Minimum Dataset for Pulmonary Rehab Program in New South Wales, and it's a Delphi method study. So pulmonary rehab program, as you all know, involve thorough patient assessment and individualized interventions to improve physical and psychological condition of people with chronic respiratory disease. And as you know, are familiar with the pulmonary toolkit that we use on a daily basis, and it has the suggestions of pulmonary rehab outcome that we should use during our assessment. Outcome measures used during patient assessment at the initial session of the program are usually repeated at the completion of the program. However, there is no consensus among pulmonary rehab program in New South Wales about which outcome measures should be collected by all pulmonary rehab programs to allow benchmarking of responses to pulmonary rehab. Currently, pulmonary rehab programs throughout New South Wales utilize different outcome measures as part of patient assessment. And this study aims to gain consensus opinion from all pulmonary rehab multidisciplinary team members in New South Wales on what outcome measures should be collected. And we hypothesize at the end of the study, a consensus will be reached on which outcome measures should be used in New South Wales pulmonary rehab program for auditing purposes. And this will also, the benchmarking process will aid service improvement and support system-wide change management for better delivery of healthcare services for people living with chronic respiratory disease. Yeah, so we really like to hear about your opinion on which outcome you would like to be collected in your pulmonary rehab program. And it is a prospective study using online Delphi survey methodology. And you are eligible to the study if your pulmonary rehab coordinator at each site of New South Wales listed on the Lung Foundation Australia website and also the New South Wales Agency for Clinical Innovation Respiratory Network group list. And if you're willing to participate by providing consent online and willing to participate in all rounds of the survey. And a survey has been, round one of the survey has been sent out, and you must use Google Chrome for the survey. If you have filled out the survey once, you don't have to fill it out again. You only need to do one survey per round. And this was initially initiated by the Agency for Clinical Innovation. Therefore, that's why the survey is only within New South Wales at the moment. And thank you for your time.
Thanks very much, Ling Ling. And it is interesting because I know there's a worldwide Delphi process at the moment through Martin Spruitt's group that you might have seen as well. So it'd be interesting to see what the New South Wales results show compared to the worldwide results. And that will be something for the future. So thanks, Ling Ling. I know we've just gone a fraction over time, but thank you all so much for sticking to time. You've done a fantastic job. I think it's really interesting to hear what's going on. So a big thank you to all our speakers. We've run out of time for questions, but they will be answered in the chat. This session was previously going to be about patient assessment, but the speakers for that weren't available. And so we swapped to this format. So the next session will be, the next meeting will be about patient assessment, which will be interesting to hear what people have to say, but also Ling Ling, it'd probably be before the results of your Delphi process are in. So we don't want to muddy the waters there too much. A big thank you to Emma again for bringing us all together as she does so well, and keep an eye out on the workspace for any notices from Emma. Is there anything else you wanted to say, Emma, before we close?
No, I just want to thank all the speakers. They all did a great job. And I've had a few messages in the chat asking if they could get copies of the presentation. So I'm going to put a link to all the presentations in the meeting minutes today. So thanks, everybody. Yeah.
And maybe just a bit of feedback, if you like this rapid presentation of what research is happening around the country, we could always include part of that in our, at least one or two of our meetings every year, to give you as researchers and also the clinicians the opportunity to hear what's happening. It's sometimes better to hear it from the researchers than read about it in a notice. So thanks all very much. We won't keep you. We know you're all very busy clinicians, but lovely to see you all. I hope you all stay well and COVID free. Take care. Okay, thank you. Bye. Bye, everyone.